This presentation is dealing with the flying qualities of Otto Lilienthal's large biplane. 130 years ago, the aviation pioneer Otto Lilienthal was the first person to invent, build, and publicly fly several aircraft. He received a US patent for his monoplane glider in 1895. Several copies of this glider were sold to customers in America and Europe. In the same year, he developed his designs further into two different biplane aircraft, of which the large biplane showed the most promise. Countless flights of both biplanes have been photographically documented, making them the first successful man-carrying biplanes in history. Amongst other experts and flight enthusiasts, the American engineer Octave Chanute corresponded with Lilienthal. By following Lilienthal's approach of carefully performing increasingly advanced flight tests, he guided several young men, amongst them Augustus Herring, towards successful flights. Finally, the Wright brothers combined the existing body of experience and knowledge with their own innovations in the field of active pilot controls and aerodynamics in their extensive glider tests between 1900 and 1902. Applying Lilienthal's step-by-step approach, they were able to achieve the first controlled powered flights in late 1903. Their breakthrough became possible because their designs exhibited reduced flight stability, complemented by reasonably effective pilot controls around all three spatial axes. The authentic Lilienthal replica of the large biplane used for the tests were built by the Otto Lilienthal Museum in Anklam, Germany. Special attention was paid to the tension of the steel wires connecting the willow longerons of the wings to the mainframe. Earlier DLR wind-tunnel tests demonstrated the influence of the permeability of the fabric, which has been woven on an original loom using a formula that was developed based on a careful analysis of a fabric sample taken from an original glider wing. The full-scale balance tests of the large biplane were conducted with the help of the test vehicle of the German Hang Gliding Association in Fürstenfeldbruck, Germany. A three-component balance was mounted on a sting at the upper end of a supporting tower structure on top of the vehicle and clamped to the glider's mainframe. Later on, the center of gravity of the glider was measured for four different body postures of the pilot in order to analyze the glider's stability and controllability. The influence of the pilot's drag was estimated by a drag penalty based on earlier tests, assuming the steady flight body posture. The elevator incidence angle was set to the middle position of 22.5 degrees. The measured lift coefficients over the angle of attack are shown here. Up to an angle of attack of 12 degrees, all lift curves exhibit a linear interval between the highest and the lowest free stream velocity. With increased velocity, the lift tends to increase at a given angle of attack. The stall begins with a gradual departure from the lift curve and low gradients near the maximum lift coefficient at an angle of attack of approximately 20 degrees. The drag polar on the right has a classical parabolic shape in the linear lift interval. The pitching moments around the glider's mainframe center are shown on the right-hand side. All free stream velocities exhibit positive pitch-up pitching moments at zero incidence angle, a negative slope of the pitching moment curve, and an intersection with the abscissa at the correct incidence angle for stable flight at constant pitch and speed. Between 10 and 25 degrees, the glider transitions into full stall with a linear decrease in pitching moment and little variation between the free stream velocities. The glider achieves a maximum glide ratio of 3.5 at a free stream velocity of 35 km per hour. The large biplane replica has been flown by three pilots: Andrew Beam from Windsports in Los Angeles, Billy Vaughan from Kitty Hawk Heights, and me. Strong wind gusts were consequently avoided because it was assumed that they can lead to a stall which can exceed the pilot's capability of maintaining the posture required for a balanced controlled flight. The glider responded promptly and predictably to the pilot's input in these configurations. As a result, the pilots were able to easily direct the glider against the wind. This proved valuable during takeoffs from a sand dune shown in this figure here. If one wing descends, here for example the left wing, the intuitive reaction of an untrained pilot is also to shift the legs to the left in order to land safely on his feet. The correct but counterintuitive response is to shift the legs towards the rising wing. This is visible in the takeoff from the sand dune here, where shear winds initially push the left wing down. To achieve a good landing of Lienthal's biplane, the pitch rotation needs to be at relatively high pitch rates to have the wing stall dynamically. The result was a short-lived overshoot, which was caused by the two-dimensional flow over the wings due to dynamic stall vortices along their leading edges. With these lessons learned, Otto Lienthal's 125-year-old feat of landing the glider on one foot was reproduced by Andy Beam, as shown here. Different pilots were able to perform smooth and safe flights followed by gentle landings, thereby achieving flight duration of up to 15 seconds and over distances of more than 100 meters. At the end of my talk here, I would like to thank you for your attention and leave the word to the two American hang glider pilots and flight instructors, Andy Beam and Billy Vaughan, who flew the large biplane on their own.
Well, I've flown the Red Glider a number of times, but I'm very pleased to have the presence of mind to look out the left wing and through the structure of that aircraft to see the Lilienthal glider flying next to me. It dawned on me after the fact that that's a view that no one's ever had, ever. It was very humbling, actually. Lilienthal glider was much more intuitive. I'm a hang glider pilot, and I was right at home. It felt fantastic and simple, and it landed just like I thought it would. Yeah, it was great.
The difficulty for flying Otto Lilienthal's glider is in that before launching, you have to set the angle of attack properly. And physically, you have to put your body in a position where you can try to pitch the nose of the glider down, not so far down that it wants to negatively go into the ground, but just at that perfect angle of attack. And then when you start to run and the glider produces lift forces, at the moment you feel light on your feet, getting your feet as far forward to lower the angle of attack to maintain energy, and then almost easing back a little bit so that the angle of attack can increase and create more lift so you can establish flight. And then from that moment, it's just a matter of swinging your feet underneath you for pitch and roll. You don't have any control over yaw, but you can control the pitch and the roll of the aircraft quite nicely. And so I was very impressed with the way he engineered his glider and how well it flew. And it was just an absolute pleasure for me to fly it.